me every time. Why'd you have to be so cute? It's impossible to ignore you. Must you make me laugh so much? It's bad enough we get along so well. Say goodnight and go. Follow you home, you've got your headphones on and you're dancing. Got a lucky, beautiful shot. Taking everything off. Watch the curtains wide open. And you fall in the same routine, flicking through the TV. Relaxed and reclining. And you think you're alone. Oh, why'd you have to be so cute? It's impossible to ignore you.
So glad to see you on campus. There are a few things that we need to let you know before we start the lecture. First, please make sure that you have your mask on all the time when you are in the classroom. Also, please make sure that when you are having a seat, try to keep a social distance with others if possible. If you feel sick, no matter it's physically or mentally, please stay at home. We do provide various online resources to keep you learning. Now, please sit back, relax, and enjoy the lecture.
Machines, and I'm going to go through a paper called The Hints of Computer System Design to as a reflection of what we have learned this quarter. So this would be, hopefully that would be one of the most influential lecture that through your study of operating system class. But you know, it's always important to remind ourselves where we are coming from. So we talk about virtual machines in the last lecture, and we say, well, the whole operating system class is actually trying to teach us the mechanism, the techniques, the design philosophy of systems that try to virtualize your resources, no matter it's processor, memory, peripherals, or whatever, in different abstractions. So this virtualization actually has various different types of presentation in terms of a taxonomy that we show here. So for operating system, we focus on process virtualization, which we try to create a virtualized environment with threads, with virtual memory that represents a modular machine. And you can actually also expose the machine in a different way by creating a virtual machine that is having a completely different architecture, like the Java virtual machine, to provide an environment for a compiled program to run. Otherwise, you can also perform the whole system virtualization in a way that you really virtualize the whole machine to house a complete operating system. And there are also several different ways of doing it. And in terms of using one machine to emulate the architecture of a completely different machine, that's typically we call emulator. So for example, if you want to play console games on desktop PC, that's possible. And that falls into the category on the most right-hand side. Oops. On the most right-hand side, showing here, right? And but that's not what we are focusing today. We are talking about virtual machines, and the virtual machines we are focusing on actually have two different architectures. One is through a virtual machine monitor. The other is through a host virtual machine monitor. Those two different architectures. So, but before we talk about those two different architectures, the whole idea of virtual machine is that we try to provide something called virtual machine monitor on top of your bare machine. And on top of this virtual machine monitor, you can host an operating system, and the operating system hosts your applications. So that's the whole idea. So with this, we have two different types of implementation. This type of implementation is probably the one that you're familiar with most, that is actually the one that you use for your project if you install VMware or VirtualBox on top of your machine, in a way that on top of your original operating system, you install VMware or VirtualBox as another application, and then you install another operating system you install another operating system in your virtual machine monitor. So that's a hosted virtual machine architecture, and that's probably the most frequently used one. But as you can imagine, right, because you still have this layer of host operating system, so there must be, and as we have learned a lot in the operating system class, one more layer, one more abstraction, you have more overhead, right? So in a lot of the performance critical settings, we tend to have this kind of virtual machine architecture that we don't have the underlying host operating system anymore. Instead, the virtual machine monitor is like a system nucleus that directly run on top of your bare machine. And the virtual machine monitor virtualize all the hardware resources for other operating systems to operate on top of this virtual machine monitor. So that's the story. Remember, that's the other type of architecture. And for this type of architecture, it's used by VMware server or Zen hypervisor that we are going to discuss today. But no matter what kind of architecture you are using to provide an environment for full system virtualization, there are three guidelines that, or say three good properties that any virtual machine should support is first, fidelity. It has to be faithfully expose the underlying hardware to the operating system running on top of the virtual machine. And which also means the operating system should feel no difference when running on top of the virtual machine compared against running on the real machine. And the second thing is performance. Even though we can faithfully prevent something, however, if it makes things too slow, that's not what we want. So performance matters. And finally, safety and isolation, because one of the purpose of running virtual machine is why don't we ask you to develop your kernel module on the real machine instead of having you set up the virtual machine? There's a reason for that, and you definitely know, right? So you don't want your development or some of your hardware or the software, which is your project, to hurt other stuff, right? So safety, isolation, and the ability to prevent disaster, well, some kind of disaster-like scenario happening in your computer system, right? So that's something you don't like, right? So so three things that are important, right? So conventional ways of achieving virtual machine has these three main ideas. The first idea is deprivileging, and the second one is using primary and shadow structures and tracing. In the last lecture, we talked about deprivileging, but before we talk about deprivileging, we have to talk about privilege. So since the introduction of THE paper, we know conventionally the designs think that your system should operate in different labels. And whenever you need to switch a label, there will be a mode switch. However, later on, we learned that if you have too many labels, then every time you need a mode switch, there is an overhead. You guys remember that, right? So modern architecture typically support at least two types of mode. One is the kernel mode and the other is the user mode. So for example, the x86 architecture has two modes. One is kernel mode and the other is user mode, which represent the ring 0 and the ring 3 in this graph. And for most of the instructions, like add, subtraction, this kind of instruction, that doesn't involve any change to critical system states or system structures or system data structures, we have them operate in ring 3, which is the normal user mode. However, whenever you need to change the system status, for example, I want to modify the page table, I want to change the page table root, I want to flush the cache with dump name, then those must be done in the privileged label, which is the kernel mode. So that's why we have the mode switch required whenever you invoke kernel functions in the system. So, but because most of the time you have your application directly running in the user mode, and we trust those code in the user mode. So those user mode instruction won't trigger any kernel operation, won't trigger any mode switch. So that's how we make the system efficient when the application only uses this user mode instructions. And based on that, right? So the conventional approach, how it works is that, okay, since virtual machine monitor is the one controls the usage of hardware among different operating systems running on top of it. So the basic idea is that the virtual machine monitor should be the one running in a privileged mode. And here's the trick, right? If the processor supports an additional mode, for example, the reduced privilege mode, then the application, if it's using a general instruction that doesn't involve any system change, like add subtraction or whatever, it directly executes on the machine. However,
whenever you have a privileged instruction invoked through a system call, then what happened is that because it needs privileged instruction, so it will be captured by the virtual machine monitor. And the virtual machine monitor has its own data structure to look into who triggers this and which operating system is hosting this application. Then turns out that handles some of the relative data structure. It will use the trap handler in the guest operating system, which hosts the application trigger that system call to handle this trap or system call. And finally, once it finishes, we can return the handler to the application as usual. And during the process, whenever there is a privileged instruction, there are something that the virtual machine monitor has to be done. So that's the whole idea of conventional system virtualization through this mechanism called trap and emulator. But as you can already hear, right, there is an issue with the modern S86 processor, as I said, if you don't have the reduced privilege mode. So that's problem one. So it won't work in this way, right? And there is another problem we will talk about later. And the other thing that, so simply trap and emulation would help us to capture the important instructions that we need to handle for a hosted an operating system on top of a virtual machine monitor. However, that's not enough because we also have other hardware software some data structure that hardware software needs to maintain together that we need to handle. And obviously, from what you have learned before, page table is one of them. So here is what I can show you an example. So if you still have the memory regarding how virtual memory works in modern systems from your learning in CS203 and 202, this is what happened. So you should remember that all your applications are running on top of virtual memory abstraction. So all the CPUs are using instruction described in virtual addresses. And because they are virtual addresses, so typically you need address translation. And there is an architecture support called TLB, translation look-aside buffer, try to accelerate that. And however, if we cannot find that translation, turns out that we need the operating system to assist us in walk through the page table and give us the right translation, right? So that's the case. That's what happened if the TLB misses. So if with TLB, right, most of the time you can avoid that thing. However, if TLB misses, you need to figure out which page table entries contain the right abstraction translation for me. You might not be aware that there is an issue here. However, thinking about this, right? Now, if we have a virtual machine in the middle, so the application running on top of your guest operating system and the virtual machine monitor is the one who physically controls the allocation of physical memory locations among different virtual machines, right? So there are two levels of administrations of virtual machine, virtual memory here. Your application requests virtual addresses from your guest operating system. And your guest operating system has to request memory locations from virtual machine monitor, right? So originally there's only one layer of abstraction, but now it becomes two layer. However, we only have one TLB. How does that thing work, right? So turns out that, well, the naive solution is that, so if we forget about TLB, right? The whole process would be, first of all, the operating system itself has a page table. And the virtual machine monitor itself also has another page table, right? So every address has to go through two layers of translation. However, right, for TLB's perspective, what kind of mapping should I be caching? Should I cache
this one or this one?
Neither is efficient, right? Because if you catch only one side, the other side always need translation. So that's not fast enough. So instead of confused TLB about what to catch, we actually create another data structure called shadow page table, which is a another layer of another kind of page table that stores the mapping between the user space virtual address to the virtual machine monitor's machine address. So instead of, so it's an alias, so it gives you the direct translation between, so originally, right, without the shadow structure is virtual address to physical address and to machine address. But now with that translation, right, it's going to virtual address to machine address. So this is the shadow page structure. And your TLB is caching this shadow page structure. So that's the whole idea of this shadow page structure, right? And with this, it helps us to address the address translation issue efficiency in this kind of setting. So, so now we have the shadow structure to address the efficiency of translation. Now, the last question that we need to address, next problem we need to address is that we have this shadow structure, but how do we know how to, when and how to update it? So that turns out would be the third mechanism we mentioned here called tracing. So the idea of tracing is that it traces accesses to important system data structures. So, what it does is that we didn't ask you to do this, but I put a hint in the project, ask you to study the usage of nmap, right? You guys remember that, right? So one of the feature of nmap is that you can set protection bits to arbitrary pages in a system. So the idea of tracing is that for important system data structures, for example, the page table, right? In the guest operating system, we can protect the memory pages used for storing their page tables. And we can set it to be read-only. So whenever an application or when the operating system itself wants to modify the page table, that will trigger a memory exception. And that will be captured by your virtual machine monitor. So the virtual machine monitor will figure out, haha, the guest operating system is right now trying to modify its page table. And that's the time I should get involved to help the guest operating system get the right physical address. And I can also update the shadow page structure. So that's the idea of tracing. So originally, if you don't do this, those pages are not protected. The guest operating system can directly modify its structure without notifying the virtual machine monitor. But once you use the mechanism called tracing, you can set a protection bit to make sure that whenever someone is trying to modify these protected pages, it will notify whoever is now in a kernel mode to deal with that. So that's how the tracing works together to maintain this kind of important system structure as long as the shadow data structure. So these three things sounds work, but however, on top of the S86 machine, this idea doesn't work. So you read a paper on how to implement the S86 virtual machine on S86. So Can you go through this statement to evaluate which of the following describe the reasons? All right, let's wrap up in 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Time is up. Okay, so after the first round, most of you think is C. So two of them are correct. So what are the two that you guys think that is correct, that are correct? Which one? Is the first one correct? The guest always can be aware that it's not running in a privileged mode. So this one is not true? Not true. How about the second one? A privileged instruction in the guest operating system may not trigger a trap.
Because VMN can't handle it.
Okay, how about the third one? SAE6 does not provide a mechanism to set write protected pages and handlers for tracing. How about the fourth one? S86 hardware walk hierarchical page table structure prevents the use of shadow page tables. You think the fourth one is correct? You think the first one is not correct? People don't know what three is talking about. Okay, so what about the second one? A privileged instruction in a guest operating system may not trigger a trap. How come? If you have a privileged instruction, how come it's not triggering a trap? And talking about the first one, the guest operating system can be aware it is not running in a privileged mode. What does that say? And if that's true, what does that mean? So if this is true, you said the guest OS will be aware. Okay, so that's not talking about this, right? So for a guest operating system that is not modified,
and it won't know that it's running on the VM.
It won't know that it's running on the VM. Wait, it's aware that I'm not in a privileged mode. What does that mean? I'm supposed to be running on a privileged mode, right? But now I'm not running in a privileged mode. What does that mean? Like, this is Valentine's Day. I'm supposed to date with my significant others, but he or she said that, well, I'm not available. What does that mean? Are you aware of something now? What do you think? So if the first one is true, which good property of the virtual machine breaks? The fidelity, right? And yeah, my step Valentine's Day example also say this betrays fidelity, right? So, and the sad thing is that this is true. So the guest operating system cannot can observe that it has been deprivileged when, okay, so here's the thing, right? We talk about segments. We talked about segments before in the virtual memory part, right? And we said there is no true implementation of segmented based virtual memory right now. However, historically, because operating systems are still using a segment based idea, and you know x86 has been such a historical processor architecture. So there still exists a register called segment selector, which allows the operating system to check where I am and where is my preview level. So as long as the operating system has instructions to check on that, and unfortunately they do, and they will be aware that I'm not in a preview level, right? So it's like, yeah, your significant others share the calendar with you, and you check the calendar. Oh, not available, right? Something is wrong, right? So same thing here, right? It's visible to the operating system, and the operating system can easily check that and figure out that, okay, I'm not the one running in a privileged mode. I'm not the one dating with you on a Valentine's Day. Right, then turns out that well, I know it's not running in a previous mode, so this betrays the fidelity property that a virtual machine should give the guest operating system. So the first one is actually one of the main reasons why S86 cannot directly adapt the idea of trap and emulation. And the thing is, there are also instructions that can operate in dual mode in S86. See, S86 is such a problematic architecture in such a way. So there are instructions that doesn't necessarily trigger in privileged mode, right? And so for example, the POPF, right? This instruction can change both the ALU flags and the system flags. However, if you don't have it running in the privileged mode, it still works. And however, right, this it won't try to modify the IF register, IF flag. Then no privilege instruction will be triggered, right? So then this instruction is actually pretty problematic in a way that, well, if your code is currently in kernel mode, it will have different behavior. However, it's supposed to be in kernel mode, but if it's not in the kernel mode, this instruction still works, but it will behave differently. And nothing in a privileged mode would occur, right? So this is actually an issue. Now, the third thing is not true, because I just told you, right? You can use MF and prepack to make that happen. And the fourth thing, right? You can actually, so remember that, right? How the S86 works is that there is a register called BR3, which is the one that when you context switch, the processor will use the CR3 register as the base register of the root node of a page table to walk through if TLBness occurs. So what does that mean? As a virtual machine monitor, you have full control over the processor. Whenever there is a context switch, and remember context switch supposed to be in the kernel mode. So if we do it right, when context switch occurs, the operating system needs to be in kernel mode. So the virtual machine monitor will get involved. And at that time, as long as we can set the register of CR3 values to the shadow page table instead of the original operating system page table, we are good. Can you get it? So with that shadow page table structure, now your system has three different versions of page table. One is the page table in your guest operating system, which translate your application address to the physical addresses that your virtual machine monitor present as an illusion to the guest operating system, as well as a physical address to the real machine address that your virtual machine monitor maintains. Additionally, to make the CPU address translation table walk translation faster, to make the idea of TLB faster, we also set up a shadow page table in the virtual machine monitor, which could also be structured as exactly as the S86 requirement to facilitate that translation, right? So 3 and 4, technically, those are possible still. So tracing is not an issue. Shadow page table structure is not an issue. It's more of an issue of the first thing, the fidelity issue, because instructions do not behave the same on virtual machine and without virtual machine. So that's the main issue of S86. So two of them are still true. However, there are privileged state is made visible to your applications. The second thing is that there are instructions, they behave differently. They are like spies on dual side, right? They behave differently to the operating system, to the application. And once your operating system is treated as an application, they behave differently as your operating system is running in the kernel mode. So that creates the issue. So if we want to implement a virtual machine on S86, you have to see what this paper has done. So the idea of this paper is that, well, since we cannot use trapped emulation, we propose another idea called binary translation. So what binary translation is that? Well, for those instructions that are problematic, that we can dynamically translate them into the right sequence of instructions when they are running in the virtual machine monitor. So how does that work? So the thing is, the virtual machine monitor has to examine. So if the virtualized processor is now in the user mode, which means that your guest operating system is just running a regular application. However, if a system call is invoked, which means that the guest operating system together with the requesting application, the process is running in a kernel mode, which is not really, really a kernel mode at this point, then the virtual machine is aware of that. Right. So first of all, when you trigger a system call, the virtual machine will still capture them. That's for sure. Right. However, what's really problematic is that you cannot that the operating system handle and run in its deprivileged mode. However, you also don't want it to be always in the kernel mode. So it turns out this is what the virtual machine monitor can do, is that, okay, you are running this system handler. Let me sneak in your system handler to see what are the upcoming sequence of instructions that you are going to run. Then I look over this instruction sequence. I have a template for this instruction. If I found it here, let me translate it to another set of instructions and then put it back to the code cache. So that's the whole idea of binary translation. Okay, so this is how TREP and emulate can work together with binary translation. So this part doesn't change. Whenever there's a system call, the virtual machine monitor handles the virtual CPU status. This is still the same as usual. And I can call the TREP handler. But in the meantime, the virtual machine monitor can definitely do something in a way that I go ahead and look over the instruction of this TREP handler and see if anyone gets translated. And if there is some spatial instruction occurs, right, I could use the translated instruction and run this in through an update. And this translated instruction would update the necessary virtual CPU status as usual, and then how handle them, get the whole system call handle. So that's the idea of binary translation. Go ahead, look at what's going on, translate those instructions, and execute the sequences of translated instruction instead of the original instruction. So that's the idea of virtualization, binary translation. And another thing that SAD6 supports for virtual machine execution is the hardware virtualization. Although it calls hardware virtualization, it's nothing different than, well, it's nothing too special than just giving you a set of new instructions that performs the following. So first of all, the SAD6 again has the contract with the virtual machine monitor that you can define, you can store data in a virtual machine control block. Sounds like process control block. Indeed, the virtual machine control block just give you a set of CPU states that are necessary to be recorded before you call invoke any hardware virtualization instruction. And they provide a new mode of execution code, guest mode. And how do you get into the guest mode? Is you can use a VM run instruction to enter the guest mode. So there's still a mode switch here, right? So here's the thing, right? S86, they remove ring one and ring two. However, because the demand of virtual machine, they added another mode back, which is somewhat equivalent to the deprivileged mode. However, to enter this deprivileged mode, there is some overhead you have to pay, is that you have to fill in and update the VMCB, the virtual machine control block data structure, before you can enter this guest mode. And once you are in the guest mode, it's pretty much the same as the deprivileged mode that we described previously as the TREP emulation. So if you have power virtualization, what happens is that as long as you want to have a system call or something that you want to be in the kernel mode, again, the virtual machine monitor does its job. However, instead of doing binary translation, what the virtual machine monitor can do is actually relatively easy that, well, we call the VM run instruction, which automatically saves the current status of the virtual machine control block. And then the guest operating system will be running in the guest mode, which is equivalent to the deprivileged mode, as we previously mentioned. And the x86 now handles the instruction correctly as usual. So no binary translation is necessary. And the only thing that the deprivileged mode is different from the conventional kernel mode is that there are still instructions to capture the notice of the virtual machine is that if some exceptions like page fault occurs, that will which require the virtual machine monitor to modify the shadow page structure, that would trigger the mode switch back to the privileged mode. And once the privileged mode finished its own job, again, VNROM stored the VMCD to continue the execution of the previous system handler if necessary. So that, but within this process, there is no binary translation necessary. So right now, S86 seems like we have a pretty good solution, right? We can either do binary translation or we can use this hardware virtualization. So it's always interesting to look into, right? Which one is better, right? So now this paper has a pretty good experiments regarding there are things that are good for the hardware to do. There are things for the software version to do. So can you tell within this how many of them would be a good fit for hardware virtualization? So some of you online ask, can VM and virtual machine monitors help better exploit the heterogeneous architecture? I would say this is a very big question and is a very open-ended one. So I don't have an answer to it, to be honest. And if you want to ask, if you can ask more detail, well, I would say, if you want to ask, you can follow up with that. You can ask like, what perspective are you curious about heterogeneous architectures? Then that would probably be more helpful. All right, so now let's wrap up in 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, time is up. Okay, so look at what you guys think. Well, still most of you think is C. So let me see. All right, I trust you guys see this time. So what are the two people here think that would be a good fit for hardware virtualization? What are the two? How about the first one? Executing system calls? Yeah. How come? According to the paper. Okay, where in the paper says that?
Section 5, I think.
Okay, so section 5 says executing system call. And what's the other one that you guys think the section 5 mentions that? Handling page faults? No, okay, what's the other? You only pick one, okay. What do you guys think? Okay, so here's the thing, right? Paper did say that, right? So if you check this figure, right? And here is the overhead when you're running
Windows XP, which you guys are probably used right before, right? And what it says that, well, see, and the vertical axis is the latency, right? And the horizontal axis shows the type of services and system calls, right? Indeed, software virtual machine monitor takes more time. Page fault, some of you mentioned that, right? Hardware virtual machine monitor is actually taking longer, right? And PTE mode, right? PTE modification, page table entry modification, that actually takes longer, right? And, right? But if you want to call, right? If you want to make calls, right? If you want to make calls, right? Call return, right? Software is again slower, right? So what does that mean? Is that according to the result, the short answer is that according to their experiments, right? If you want to do system call, if you want to do general function call, hardware is a good solution. However, for page fault related stuff, it becomes slower. Can you think about why? What's the difference between binary translated page fault handling and not binary translated page fault handling? What's the difference? So we said for binary translation, right? What are you going to do? For binary translation, what are you going to do? I go ahead, predict what's going on, and redirect the code to the translated code. And the translated code, if you have a shadow page structure, then what happens is you just translate the code to be some code that can modify both structures. Okay, so now, if you have a VM, if you have a hardware, what are you going to do? So you let the page fault handler trigger an exception. And this exception, because it's in the privilege mode. So, and this is a special instruction, it will trigger a VM access instruction, which restore context from the VMCB. Go back to the VMN. The VMN handles it. Call the VM run again. And the VM run does what? Fill data into the VMCB again. To continue the execution of the rest of the operating system feature. Right. Okay. So the amount of work that the VMN has to be done is pretty much the same as the amount of work that the translated binary needs to be done. Agree with that? However, there is an overhead when you need to fill the VMCB or restore states from the VMCB when you need to handle your control back to your virtual machine monitor. So the overhead actually comes from the mode switch. However, for binary translated version, because we just let a handler run the binary translated code in their original mode, so there potentially won't be any mode switch. So the overhead here purely coming from the fact that you have to do mode switch. However,
for operations that doesn't need mode switch when you use hardware BMM,
then you don't suffer from this overhead. And the binary translation will become the overhead. Can you get it? So here's the thing, right? The hardware virtual machine monitor, the hardware virtualization does come with an overhead, which mainly is the overhead of switch between the guest mode and the privileged mode, which you cannot ignore in a permit implementation. All right, so they do evaluate quite a few benchmarks. And as you can see, hardware VMN is not always a win, right? There are cases that the software is presenting better. There are cases where hardware is better, right? So, which tells you that it's still an open question, or say there, it depends, right? So there is no absolute answer that hardware virtualization is going to be a better one, or software binary translation is going to be a better one. Instead, depending on what situation you want to handle, you have to take the strategy differently. So that's why VMware has hired a lot of computer architects, or a lot of people do performance evaluation, because they have to be careful in evaluating this operation, this latency, how many cycles it takes, to decide which strategy we need to implement the mechanism of handling this virtualization. So that's very important. So the answer is that everything involving page fault handling, that's actually the weakness of hardware virtualization, because page fault, well, another thing is that, right? Because page fault handling is something we want to make it fast enough. So typically the software can handle it, and with sufficient amount of hardware support, typically we can make it relatively faster. And turns out that, and it's a highly optimized one. So it turns out that the VM run and VM exit instruction overhead becomes more significant, right? All right, so two of them. So side-by-side comparison, right? There is no clear winner between the software version and the binary translation. It's all about under what situation that is better for your case. So it's really important that sometimes you have to figure out and think carefully about which one you want to take. All right, so one of the last paper we have to talk about for this quarter is Zen and the Art of Virtualization. And why this paper title is because the author was actually a fan of motorcycle maintenance. So the Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, that's why they have this title. All right, so, well, but the real why of Zen, right? The real why of Zen is that, well, we want to have, well, so there are a lot of good things about virtualization, right? And it's really a good idea that we can, especially in the era of cloud, we want to have a server that can run several server machine instances together on a single machine to fully utilize the hardware, right? If you are Google, you love that, right? And in fact, you know, every cloud service is like that. You basically go to Amazon EC Square, or you go to Windows Azure Cloud or Google Cloud, you subscribe a machine instance, virtual machine instance, which typically just give you one or two cores, but you definitely know it's a virtual machine, because how can you buy a server machine with only one or two cores right now, right? So that must not be a true machine for you. So here's the thing, right? So this kind of virtual machine instances actually powered most of the cloud virtual machine services right now, because they have very good reasons of doing that. First of all, I can partition the physical machine resources to many, many other customers, and
Most of the time, I bet on the things that not all customers would use the service all the time. And if I'm smart enough, right, I can provision the machine in a smart way that, well, I can mix the machine with a few virtual machine instances. Some of them are from Asia, some of them are from the United States, and you know the time differences, right? So the whole machine running 24 hours, however, the peak hour of the United States is this time, the peak hour of Asia is this time. So the whole machine would be used globally at 100% loaded most of the time. And if your virtual machine is doing good enough, it has safety isolation. So one customer won't affect the other one and is well isolated, so data won't be leaked, everything should be secure if the machine is good enough, right? So there are tons of reasons. However, performance is really an issue. So Zen actually proposed, it's online here to address that. This idea is called paravirtualization. So can you see how many of the following describes the idea of paravirtualization? All right, looks like we got sufficient amount of votes in. So let's wrap up in 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, time is up. Okay, so, wow, why everybody always picks C? Is that like a French prediction or something? What's the answer of that? Okay, I guess. Well, we need some discussion this time. So why don't you go ahead and discuss with your friend for another minute or two. Go. Let's see. All right, people online, go ahead.
Yeah.
All right, let's wrap up in 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Time is up. Okay, after discussion. Still see. So it's interesting, huh? So let me see. I have tortured people in person here enough. So let me see those who online. So group one, can I have some of you talking about what you saw? Group one, I have Yitong, I have Sivron, I have Sidon, I have Name, I have Jeffrey, I have Dennis, I have Washiwara, I have Aditi. Anyone, shout it out. Unmute yourself, say something. Someone online? All right. I love you guys. Do I need to express more love for me on you? What do you guys think? Okay, group two online. Abraham, Hui, Armin, Rohit, Xi Yu, Sherian, Sharisha, Tianze, and Ziren. Anyone like to share? What do you guys talk about during the discussion? Let me hear your voice. All right, student on strike. All right, how about the first one? Pair virtualization requires guest operating system and applications to be modified. Is that true?
Yeah.
No? Where did you find that?
Personal experience?
Have you ever tried pair virtualization? No? Okay. So here's the thing, right? Where do you think pair virtualization used the most intensive? As I said, server, right? Which kind of server? Amazon server or like Microsoft, right? Google, right? Okay. Remember that. Okay, so is the first one true? If you write a paper, the first one is actually true, right? Application doesn't need to be modified. However, the operating system needs to be modified.
Right, that's why it kind of threw me off.
Yeah, but sometimes the wording is interesting, right? So not both the application and operating system needs to be modified. The operating system needs to be modified. And most of the time, you are not aware of it. Because of what? Remember, when you subscribe a virtual machine instance, it's already optimized and provided by the provider. So sometimes, right, you might think, well, Ubuntu 20.04 has a new kernel available. How come it's not available on my cloud service provider? Because they are still modifying it, right? So here's the thing, parallel virtualization require the guest operating system to be optimized, to be modified. And they have a reason for that. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. It allows guest operating system to be correctly virtualized without binary translation in VMM. That is true. So the second statement actually tells you parallel virtualization can make the performance better. However, it's cheating, right? Because they actually make the binary translation become part of the operating system code. So instead of using binary translation, we just modify the operating system's trap handler to not use problematic instructions, right? So you don't need binary translation. Do you agree with that? Right? So parallel virtualization is cheating on this, right? Allows guest operating system to better support time-sensitive tasks. That's why we want parallel virtualization, because we don't need binary translation, we don't need to suffer from the overhead of VM run exit, because we modify the operating system code to avoid that, right? Finally,
the operating system can directly modify the physical to machine address map directly because we just make that part of the GS operating system code. Right. So to be honest, paravirtualization is not real virtualization because it already accepts the fact that if we want to maintain the fidelity, the performance must be sacrificed. So there is no perfect virtual machine standard. Like there is no perfect my partner. Okay, you must feel like the professor's personal life stops, right? That's true. but here's the thing, right? Paravirtualization accepts the fact that, well, if you really want fidelity from the underlying virtual machine monitor, then there must be some supervision sacrifice in your performance because of the current architecture. It looks like that. So three of them are correct. And here's how Zen works. So the basic idea of Zen is we have a paravirtualization, which, okay, we gave up the fact that you don't have to modify your guest operating system. Let's modify it. But we modify it to a certain degree. It's like, okay, I now notice that there is no perfect light pattern. So I'm actually willing to do some sacrifice on my end, change myself. Right? Don't you feel that real now? So we change the operating system in a way, right? We replace sensitive instructions that doesn't trap or don't trap to the ones that will trap, right? Problematic instruction is just not using, right? Okay, avoid them, right? Modify the operating system call. And the guest operating system makes hypercall to interact with system resources. And in this way, right? So the hypervisor, or say your Zen, can provide protection between virtual machines still if you really need services from the virtual machine monitor to allocate physical resources. So when you are dealing with IO memory allocation, make a hypercall to the Zen, right? So hypercall is replacing system calls in a certain way. And because you modify the operating system, so the operating system knows where can I use the system call, where can I use the hypercall, right? So the whole thing is kind of cheating, right? So operating system can choose if I want to have the VMN involved on my end. And if I need a VMN to be involved, the VMN can handle exceptions for those situations. So what happens is that if you want to compile your operating system for Zen hypervisor, instead of you compile it as like S86, 64, I1686, this kind of general flag, you have to change your architecture flag as Zen. So the operating system that supports Zen hypervisor knows that, okay, this code must be compiled on top of the architecture of Zen instead of the S86. So that's paravirtualization. Okay, so here's their claim, right? Their claim is that, the amount of code that you have to modify is actually not a lot. So for Linux, you only need to modify about 3,000 lines of code. And for Windows XP, only 4,600 of lines of code modifications are necessary. Comparing against the whole code base, right? For Linux, it's only 1.1% of the code modification. For Windows XP, it's only, 0.4%, right? So how big the XP code is. Right, but they are trying to tell you, convince you that the amount of modification is really minimal, right? But as a software engineer, you know, finding out what are the 3,000 lines to modify is actually a big amount of work, right? But the whole idea of paravirtualization is trying to modify the code directly to avoid a the overhead of mouse switch or binary translation. So let me give you an example of how their modification will work. So we remember that, right? So if you have the Zen hypervisor, if we can modify the operating system code running on top of Zen, then we potentially can avoid the usage of shadow page structure, right? So then what happened is that if you don't have a shadow page, right, whenever there is a TLB mess, right, you can directly walk through the page table within the guest operating system, right? And in this case, there's no additional overhead that are necessary for virtual machine learning to get in. However, if you are accessing the page, but page fault occurs, right, then it's really a case that you have to figure out that, well, how to allocate the right page for the operating system. Then that's the time that you need Zen to get involved. So what would happen is that that's the only case. And remember, the page fault handler is part of the operating system code, and we will modify that. So instead of directly using a system call, here, whenever page fault occurs, the page, the guest operating system would trigger a hyper call, which the operating system can pick. So here's the thing. On Zen, if you directly run a guest operating system without being modified, then at this point, the operating system would make a system call, which the VM would never capture. However, if you make a hyper call, it will be captured by the VMN, and the VMN would figure out and tell the guest operating system which is the right page you should now use for this mapping, for this page fault. So here is the trick, right? We just modify the operating system code. And there are a lot of interesting things that I would encourage you to go ahead and study for this paper, like the Bloom driver and
how they achieve IO virtualization. And so because they train it, so you can see for this performance graph, right? So the left hand side, there are four bars here. The first two, they are two different types of Linux, native Linux kernels, and So the first one is the native Linux, and the second one is their modified Zen version of the Linux, and the third one is the VMware workstation, and the last one is the user mode Linux. And as you can see, Zen hypervisor most of the time it's pretty much perform similarly as the native Linux, but you know the reason, right? Because they kind of like modify the program code to be aware, and they can get to choose, and there's no overhead, and there is little overhead when they ask for virtualization. So here is the overhead they mentioned is a significant reduction. All right, so finally, we are not ended yet. Last paper, and I want to walk through this paper real quick because it's actually the paper you will use the most intensively on your final. So this paper is by Bartlett Levinson, and he is one of the most influential system designer in the world. And you must remember, right, whenever there is a problem, then we add an abstraction. That's his words. Okay, so what he said about the computer system design. So he has a lot of philosophy regarding the system design here. So for example, if you want to make sure that the completeness of your system, you have to first separate the normal and the worst case, and for the normal and the worst case, you should deal with them differently in different philosophy. And for the interface, they do have a pretty good
guideline for you, like do one thing well and try to keep interface stable, right? And try to keep a place to stand. And for implementation, right, plan to store one away, keep secret, use a good idea, again, divide and compare. So those are the good guidelines that he mentioned in this paper. And so one of the examples that he talked about separate normal and worst case. So we are short on time. So just curious, anyone here would like to share? How many of the following or which of the following do you think now represent the separation of normal and the worst case?
F4,
how come is that the case? They have warm and hot storage, right? So they separate different cases, like the normal case and worst cases. And so warm storage is like the worst case scenario, right? And the normal case is like the hot storage, right? And if it's the worst case, we separate the handling of it, right? So that's one proof of the design philosophy. Completeness, right? So we read the paper about saturation and threshing. And when we talk about those papers handling the worst case scenario like saturation and threshing, and I do have the question regarding what this paper is trying to optimize for. And the answer is they are not optimized for anything because they cannot really optimize for anything, everything, right? So the only thing that you can make in the worst case scenario is that at least the system is in a stage that we can move forward. So for example, like stretching, saturation, instead of seeking for the best performance, no, just make the system working. That's good enough, right? So that's one of the examples that we can mention here. And interface, you guys probably have a lot of experience with that. You would definitely hate an API that changes all the time. Right, so try to keep it simple, stupid, and we also love that because as a programmer, I don't want to remember the order of arguments, and if it's too complicated, it's so easy for me to mess things around. Right, so you want things to be simple. You want things to be stupid. Well, and but if you want. If you want to make that happen, right, don't make your function too complicated, right? So keep it simple, right? So do one thing at a time or do it well, right? And most important, right? Like what we want you to do in your project is get it right, right? Forget about performance first, get it right. That's more important. All right, moral interface, right? So for example, they have more teachings on that. Don't high power. This procedural argument provides flexibility. Limit to the client, make it faster rather than general and powerful. And there are so many things that we should probably dig into for this paper. And for speed, we probably learned a lot, like caching is a good idea, and dynamic translation, like binary translation, right? And sometimes, right, if we want to guarantee the quality of service, fixed allocation is better than dynamic, right? And so those are the stuff. And fault tolerance, right, make actions atomic and restartable, for example, right? Or you want to crash recovery, then log is a good idea, right? So from the example of this paper, from what they talk about in this paper, it's actually a pretty good summary about what are the techniques or philosophy that we learned for this quarter. And finally, you care does a lot. So for the final exam, there will be two parts. The part one, take any 18 minutes. And for the part two, actually, I think for part two, I actually made it available 6 p.m. from today. And the reason is because I kind of like make a mistake that I made it a little bit more open-ended than I would imagine. So I want to, so my suggestion is this, right? Forget about what I put in a slide. After 6 p.m. today, open the test, don't submit it, the part one, right? Part two. Open it, see what are the questions, and you have
about 6 days minus 1 hour because daylight saving time, right? to think about what are the answers to this question, right? And part one is pretty similar to your midterm in a certain way. We have multiple choice. We have free answer questions, and I won't go through those questions because we are short on time. The only interesting question that you would never see in the past is that you guys read 23 papers this quarter, and oh shit, I heard about that. Right? So the thing is that I would have a ton of questions asking you about if you are interfacing this problem, which paper should you read? All right. Other than that, thank you all for this great quarter, and thank you all for being here. And for those of you who are around, we can take a photo together. For other people, I will see you online. I will see you in the future. And thank you.